This is the Brave New Coin Crypto Conversation, hosted by Andy Pickering.
Hi everyone, Andy Pickering here. I'm your host and welcome to the Crypto Conversation, a Brave New Coin podcast where we talk to the people building the future in the Bitcoin, blockchain and cryptocurrency space. Today's episode is a little bit different because today I'm joined by two of my team members from here at Brave New Coin. I'm joined by Pierre Ansardi and Paul Salisbury. Now, Pierre and Paul are here to talk about the Bitcoin halving and specifically a new Bitcoin halving countdown page that we have launched on bravenewcoin.com. Now, as you probably know, the Bitcoin halving is one of the key macro events for Bitcoin in 2020. And as we get closer to the halving, it's probably not just Bitcoiners and not even just the wider crypto ecosystem. Eventually, probably the finance guys and even the rest of the world, everyone is slowly going to become aware of the surrounding discussion and price action as well. So today's podcast is simply to announce the Bitcoin halving countdown on bravenewcoin.com. We're going to dig into that with Pierre and Paul very soon. Just before we do, I want to let you know that the next podcast episode after this one, and I'm going to put that out probably tomorrow, so depending on when you're listening, it may already even be out, but that next podcast is a chat with a guy called Rekt Capital. Now, he's a trader and analyst from London. He wrote a really interesting analysis of the last two Bitcoin halving events from a technical analysis point of view, and he's looked at the Bitcoin's price performance over its 10-year history and how the halving has impacted that. I thought it was a really fascinating piece, and so I thought it would be good to talk to him. So on that podcast, we discuss the Bitcoin halving from a technical analysis point of view. We cover stock to flow, efficient market hypothesis, whether or not the halving is or can be priced in, and loads more as well. So if you are following the Bitcoin halving, I do recommend you listen to that episode as well. With all that said, for now, let's get to today's topic of discussion, the Bitcoin halving countdown on bravenewcoin.com. Hello, Pierre, and hello, Paul. To start with, why don't you both introduce yourselves, give us a little bit of background on yourself, and tell us what it is you do here at Brave New Coin. Hello, Pierre.
Hello, Andy. Quick background on me. I was born and raised in France. I discovered Bitcoin in 2012 when I was writing a paper on cross-border payment for money laundering. Then I started my career in investment banking before moving to Deloitte in Paris and start with them the advisory branch on blockchain. But then I quit and moved to New Zealand 2 years ago and joined this adventure with Brave New Coin, where I'm leading the product development team. So any new products or any new indices engineering, as well as fundamental and qualitative research, is done by my team. And it's a lot of work and learning, but also a lot of fun.
Awesome. Well, very nice to have you here, Pierre. And welcome to the show, Mr. Paul Salisbury.
Thank you, Andy. And yeah, a bit about me. So similar to Pierre, also found Bitcoin white paper in 2011. And at the time I was in Switzerland and very much down a enterprise software route and decided to move back to New Zealand in 2012. And since I'd fallen in love with this fascination of Bitcoin, I thought, great, I'll start afresh. I'll focus in 100% on consulting around Bitcoin, wallet, security, anything technical. Always had that technical twist to my career. Yeah, eventually started Blockchain Labs, which has been quite an interesting ride, seeing now the second and third waves of blockchains come about and being able to develop smart contracts and tools on top of that. As part of my role here within the TechMe group, I'm also Chief Blockchain Officer. So any of the R&D work that we're doing that's going to touch with a blockchain, be that from a data perspective or code, I get to oversee those cool bits of R&D.
Well, Paul, you mentioned that you are, I think you're one of the founders of Blockchain Labs New Zealand. That's right, isn't it?
Correct.
And you mentioned that you have a technical twist to your career, I think is how you described it. And given that you're probably one of our major key technical blockchain guys, I think you're probably the man for the job. Why don't you give us your high-level overview of what the Bitcoin halving is, why it's an important part of Bitcoin's protocol, and why it is an important macro fundamental event for Bitcoin?
Sure. So we'll start with Bitcoin has a few fundamental rules. Most of the listeners will be familiar with that. A maximum supply of 21 million Bitcoins and halving the block rewards. Now, those are somewhat codified in the initial software that Satoshi released. And there's been many guesses why he's picked those numbers or any influences to those models. However, that's all speculation. Really, the only thing we know for certain is that the end goal was to move to only transaction fees. So whatever reward mechanism that was put in place was just to bootstrap the network. It was to get things started. And without predicting any future economic models, back in 2008, 2009, it just wasn't possible to predict all the different ways things would play out. Satoshi very much believed a simple mathematical model would suffice. There were already people back then saying, hey, let's smooth it out as a nice curve. He rather preferred that the markets smooth that out. So if there's going to be jumps, might as well let the market do what markets do best. Pretty much for the last two halvenings, that's what we've seen, whether it's the number of miners that are on the network, the hash rates, or the price movements, that's all market forces doing what they should. From a technical perspective, a new block of transactions is added to the Bitcoin blockchain every 10 minutes, approximately, and the miner that verified that block receives the block reward. Currently, that's at 12.5 Bitcoins per block, and after this next halving, that will go down to 6.25.
And from a fundamental perspective, I suppose you'd argue that, you know, that is what we would call a supply shock. And no one really knows exactly what's going to happen, but the idea is that if demand for Bitcoin stays the same, it's simply supply and demand, there's going to be 50% less Bitcoin coming into the system every day. So over time, who knows, price may rise. And that is just a really short explanation of why people are excited about the halving event from a macro perspective over a longer time frame. Pierre, let's talk about the website bravenewcoin.com and the countdown that you and your team have put together. So just give us a quick overview of what the countdown is and what the page shows, or what the data on the page shows.
Yes, Andy. So on this page, we are trying to display a lot of useful information. And when you arrive on the page, the first thing you see is this countdown. So as Paul said, every roughly 10 minutes, there is a new block added to the chain. But when we start analyzing the data, it's not actually 10 minutes. It can vary from, let's say, 8 to 11, something like that. And so when you multiply that by the number of remaining block to get the halving date, you can have quite a lot of difference if you take 10 minutes or an approximate of it. So what we did with the team is to come up with few different methodologies to assess the average block time that we will then multiply by the number of remaining block, and that gives us four prediction. We have actually built a bit more models, but we're displaying only four on this page. Most simple model is the average block from the last 24 hours. So we just take 24 hours executed block and get this average block time. But then we've done some more complex analysis where we, for example, using exponential moving average, where we are taking the last 200 days and we are applying more weight to the recent days compared to the previous one. We're also doing a simple moving average of 50 days, so just taking the last 50 days of data and getting an average. The last one is just taking into account every block since block one and getting this average block time from the last 11 years. So each give us a prediction or a forecast every day. And we are currently updating all the data in this page every day, but we are considering to move it to hourly because we are producing that hourly.
Yes, Pierre. And so just to recap that, so basically the Bitcoin halving countdown, you guys have presented four possible scenarios to try and estimate the date and time of the halving event. And so those different metrics, you mentioned a couple of them: average daily block time, cumulative average block time, a simple moving average block time over 50 days, and an exponential moving average block time over 200 days. And I'm just looking through the different scenarios now, Pierre, and So the closest estimate, I think, is scenario two, which is the cumulative average block time, which suggests that the halving will take place on the 8th of May. And the furthest out scenario is scenario one, which is the average daily block time. And that is suggesting at the moment that the halving will take place on May 12th. Have you guys got any sort of feeling amongst yourselves, and I'm pretty sure you do, as to which scenario your team feels is the most accurate?
So that's a really interesting question, because we've done some backtesting to see which methodology was the most accurate in previous halvings. It seems like the exponential moving average is the best methodology to predict the halving date 100 days before the actual date, so which is roughly today. But the closer you get from your halving date, and all methodology will converge into one same day and then one same hour, because you reduce the number of remaining blocks. And the most volatile one is the average daily block time, because from one day to another, there is quite a lot of variance in terms of block time. But my preference will be for the exponential moving average 200, because it takes into account quite a lot of history with 200 days, but also put more weight on the recent days and weeks.
And at the moment, you can see that the Bitcoin hash rate is pretty much at or near an all-time high. It's just been climbing and climbing, as has the difficulty. You see there's a lot of interest out there from miners who want to add their capacity to the network and try and compete for those block rewards. Also on the page, you've got a chart that shows miners' revenue versus the price volatility and the hash rate of the miners who are contributing to the network. Can you just briefly explain what this chart shows?
Yeah, sure. So we had to decide what we wanted to present on this page amongst everything that we are collecting or creating. And we ended up deciding on these three main metrics: the hash rates, which give you power of miners interested in contributing to the network, the miners' revenue, which is the incentive for them to do so, and then the volatility, which explains kind of the market activity happening off-chain on exchanges. So with these three indicators, you can have a sense of the momentum and what is going on. So on the page, you have three charts. One is a live one with basically what is happening since the last halving. And you have two other charts which show you what happened on first and second halving. So you can see if history repeats itself or not. Everything is supposed to help you understand what the price will do.
Yes, well, speaking, Pierre, of understanding what the price will do, I remember back in October last year when you and your team, you did an internal presentation to the rest of us here at Brave New Coin and showed us what you were doing. And just to gamify the whole experience or make it a little bit more fun for those of us with a little bit of skin in the game, you asked us to submit their best guess for the halving. And I went back into my emails to see what I said back then in October last year. And my guess, I said May 16, 13 minutes past 12 and 7 seconds. How do you think I'm doing? It feels like I may just be 4 days out at this point, doesn't it?
Yeah, I think you might be a bit late on this one, Andy, but we got a lot of interesting prediction, and there will be a winner and a party to celebrate that.
Excellent, excellent. There's lots of other daily data there as well, such as the percentage of Bitcoins mined, how many Bitcoins left before the halving, total blocks to be mined before the halving, and as you alluded to, some of the price performance stuff there as well. Just for fun, let's bring Paul back into the conversation as well. I'd love to get just some informal comments from you both, because it is really just speculation, but any thoughts on what you expect to see regarding the Bitcoin halving? So yeah, interested in your thoughts.
Yeah, I'm fortunate. My guess for the internal competition was May the 9th, so I'm still in with the chance there. From a broader perspective, it is positive to see that the hash rate hasn't changed, that we're not seeing miners, you know, kind of decreasing or anything there. And really, so much more happens after the halving. So I do expect that even if we don't see much price movement in the next couple of months, post-May is where it's really critical. So we'll be watching out for that.
Yes, I completely agree, Paul. You know, to some extent, the halving is just an arbitrary quirk of the Bitcoin protocol, and everyone, of course, is aware of what's going to happen. So from that perspective, you know, that's why a lot of people, especially more from traditional markets, tend to think that the Bitcoin halving is priced in, because, of course, it's publicly available information. But, you know, based on the last two halvings, we have seen exponential increases in price. That bull market really kicks in following the halving. Pierre, what are your thoughts?
There is one thing that we know, is that currently the block reward is about 90% of the miners' revenue. So after the halving, this part will decrease by half. So if the miners want to have the same profitability, either the fees has to increase or the price of Bitcoin. So I think in the past we've seen the price increasing a lot, and we'll see if this time history repeats itself.
Yes, we will. It's certainly going to be interesting to watch all this play out. Are you guys watching Google Trends? Google Trends search results for Bitcoin halving are really starting to ramp up. Something exciting to keep an eye on as well.
Yes, in my team, we're looking at multiple trends like that, and we are collecting tweets every day. And so one of the things that we are doing is analyzing topics around these tweets. The one thing we've found out is that the number of tweets mentioning halving and Bitcoin have more than tripled since October, so that's confirming what Google Trends said.
Let's start to finish off then. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining me today for what is probably one of the shorter and sweeter Crypto Conversation podcasts, but I did want to just keep this one nice and quick, just so we could explain what is happening with the Bitcoin block reward halving on bravenewcoin.com. We have done that. To finish off, I'd love to hear just a little bit about what you guys are working on with your respective teams for the rest of 2020. Please, go for gold.
All right. So my team is quite busy for this year, as you know, Andy. One of the projects we have is to go further in Twitter analysis and move on and compare price and sentiment on tweets. Another project is about creating a volatility index using the finally ready option market, and we are working around with Paul on a different on-chain project as well, so that's quite exciting.
Excellent. And Paul?
Yeah, as Pierre mentioned, on-chain analytics, it's quite a huge volume of data that's coming from not just Bitcoin but also Ethereum and the other chains, so mining that and producing interesting analytics and trends off of that. Also building systems that react to what's happening on chain, right? So we're looking at pending transactions, the data encoded in those transactions even before they're confirmed, and how that can then inform either decentralized applications or other risk models and frameworks.
Fascinating. Well, actually, Paul, we should get you back on to do a blockchain lab specific episode sometime. Would you do that?
Absolutely. I'd look forward to it.
Awesome. Well, we will do that, but I think we will leave it there for now. So thank you, Pierre, and thank you, Paul.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Well, there you go. That was a short but sweet episode of the Crypto Conversation. As I said, links will be in the show notes to the bravenewcoin.com Bitcoin halving, a couple of other notes that we mentioned today. And also, please don't forget that the next podcast episode after this one is also very much a Bitcoin halving specific episode. That is the one with Wrecked Capital. He's a TA guy, has a lot of really interesting analysis around Bitcoin's price performance related to the last two halving events and what he expects to see with this halving. And specifically, as Paul mentioned, really it's all about what happens after the halving. But spoiler alert, you know, Wrecked Capital, it probably won't surprise you to hear that he is very bullish indeed. But if you'd like to hear more about his analysis, as I say, it's the episode after this one, and I think we'll just leave it there. So hey, thanks for listening. This was the Crypto Conversation for Brave New Coin.